Jai Hind and welcome to Dev Talks. This is Adi Achin. There's a lot of violence happening in Kashmir and we need to analyze what is the latest spurt. Is this just a phase or this is a new style of terrorism that we're going to see in Kashmir? To discuss this, I have with me Lieutenant General Satish Dua, BVSM, UYSM, SM, BSM, who served as the Chief of the Integrated Defence Staff, Corps Commander 15 Corps in Srinagar. Very important for our discussion today. And of course, the man behind the surgical strikes. He's today an expert on anything that happens within the valley and his opinion is much sought after. A strategic speaker and an author of a book, India's Brave Hearts. Thank you, sir, for joining me today.
Thank you, Adi. It's good to be interacting with you and discussing these topics, as always.
Thank you, sir. So I'm going to just open up at a broad base and then we'll come to the crux of our discussion, the type of killings which are happening in Kashmir today. The entire situation seems to be on a boil. A lot of people would attribute this situation to Afghanistan. Is that what you think or is this just a phase of infiltrations and violence before the winter sets in?
Adi, any one answer would be an oversimplification. So, while both the factors that you mentioned, Afghanistan and an annual cycle of before the winter's kind of a setting, while both of them would have a part to play, but I see a larger and a sinister design in this. And let me discuss that first. Targeted killings, soft targets, picking up influential civilians, citizens. It is, to my mind, designed to throw back a fear in the minds of people. And why is it required? It is required, I think, from their point of view, from the terrorist point of view, because over the last 2 years, ever since they were, Article 370 has been diluted, things are showing improvement. The state of affairs, there is an improvement. I know everybody will try to jump at me and say, there have been so many killings in the last 2 days and you're saying things are improving. Now we're taking a larger picture over 2 years. Life is moving toward normalcy. Tourists are coming back again. There is a lot of business and economy and the trade is picking up and there is a lot of enhancement in economy. The violence on streets is very less. Recruitment towards in the terrorists amongst terrorists is going down. The security situation in terms of the freedom of movement to terrorists is really improving. With all this happening, the terrorist groups and they have another issue. The terrorist groups have an issue that because of the FATF compliances. There are a lot of curbs are being placed on them from their masters across also. So all in all, this is, to my mind, there either it is a frustration showing or a proper strategy to strike at the civilians. Because as we were discussing earlier, if you throw lob a grenade at a security post or an army camp, it does not matter so much to the civilians, to the citizens. But this way, you strike terror into the heart of the people. And if you try to strike terror into the hearts of people, that is where the fear starts to come back. And that feeling of all is good, normalcy, moving towards normalcy, then starts ebbing away. So I would like to, before I end, I'd like to say that this is a proper plan to nudge everyone back into the domain of fear again. Yes, there is, the terrorist groups are emboldened by the fact that Taliban has managed to usurp a superpower and it is in control in Afghanistan today. It happens world over. All terrorist groups will draw heart from that. It is also a fact that annually, it is at this time of the year, that is before the winter sets in, that activities and violence, that is activities of infiltration across the LOC do pick up. And violence levels do tend to show an increase every year.
So you mentioned the targeted killings, and you're saying it's to provide a certain amount of fear within the civilians. That will help their motive of destabilizing the entire place. But in a larger game, that will not help the backers, which are the Pakistanis' motives. How do you see that entire situation?
You are absolutely right. And actually, that is what we, the state, the security forces, everyone should try to encash on. Because if you strike terror into the hearts of the people, when you do targeted killings, or even killing of, even if they're not targeted killing, when civilians, this common citizen, the common man is being targeted, well, the terrorists tend also to lose the support that they have from amongst the masses. So they have to draw, the terrorists have to draw a judicious balance between how much they can antagonize the people in a bit to shake away this the normalcy bit that is going on. So to that extent, you are right. But the terrorists are weighing their pros and cons, because as things move towards normalcy, that situation is certainly not acceptable to them. And let's also remember that because of the ceasefire on the LOC, the violence activity, I beg your pardon, the infiltration activities from across the LOC have reduced considerably. We had only one odd group infiltration attempt last week where a terrorist was killed and one was captured. So otherwise, because all these things are showing a decrease, it is very important for terrorists from their point of view. And as I read it, they are trying to now instill fear in the hearts of the people.
Something is better than nothing for them, sir. That I agree with. So another thing which is coming out in recent times, and you've mentioned this, that the infiltration attempts from across the LOC is very, very difficult because of the grids that have been established by the Indian Army. My main question is Punjab today becoming another front for the smuggling of weapons, drugs, money, for the supply into JNK? Is this a shift of tactic, or is this another front which is actually opening up in Punjab as well?
And maybe a bit of both, Adi. Another front, but also a shift. Because in the early 90s, when the trouble broke out in Kashmir, it was initially restricted to Kashmir Valley. In the second half of the 90s, when the grid here became strong, the anti-infiltration grid as well as the counter-terrorism grid in the hinterland became robust, they shifted their center of gravity to the south of Peet Pinjar. And for the next few years, we saw a lot of militant activities, infiltrations, everything through the south of Peet Pinjar. In fact, I was the commanding officer on the LOC during those years in late 90s. And I've participated in operations south of Peet Pinjar in Punch. The terrorists that came there, through the south of Peet Pinjar, also would head towards the valley. So while their intent was to reach the valley, the route used was different. Now, what is Punjab? If you swing further south of the area of JNK, of Jammu region, that's when you hit Punjab. And that's exactly like you rightly said, they are opening up this front. We are seeing more and more incidents of weapons, of drugs, of everything being now coming in through Punjab. We've also seen infiltration attempts from there. And then it's easier to head towards JNK, towards Kashmir, from that side. So that is another front that is opening up. Linked with this, I want to give you another thought. When you said another front, enlarging on this, one is the aspect of them coming through Punjab, whether it is material support or infiltration coming through Punjab and headed to J&K. On the other hand, I remember when I was the corps commander, one of the intelligence agency's reports said, we talk about the Pak philosophy of inflicting a death by 1,000 cuts. There was another thought that that there was a thing in the wind speaking about now they're launching a death by 1,000 revolts. And the idea was, the thought was that to incite revolts in the rest of the country as well, that paralyzed the government. So when we see so many protests going on in the country, we are really not sure as to how much is genuine and how much is actually being incited by vested interests. In one or two of the movements, there was a very powerful lobby of that their hand was found in terms of material and financial support for the protests. So that is another thing that we must keep in mind, because in today's volatile atmosphere, driven so easily by social media, and everyone carries a broadcasting platform in his hand or in his or her pocket. So it is very easy to spread this kind of violence on the streets. So that is another front I think we must, as a nation, as a security apparatus, watch out for.
Indeed, sir. That's I think a nagging thought amongst all people that are looking at what is happening in the, especially the northern part of the country, and that's innocuous that it's happening in that region, as per se. So you mentioned about the ceasefire. You know, that has been holding up, and as you also said, that without the violations of ceasefire, it's very difficult to infiltrate manpower into it. We've seen tunnels, we've seen a whole lot of stuff being innovated in these times. Do you see any other kind of infiltration tactics that are going to be employed to send in manpower, looking at the fact that the local recruitment levels are falling pretty fast, actually?
So, first of all, I think the ceasefire was a very clever ploy. Came as it did in earlier part of this year in February, if I'm not wrong. It was clever because Pakistan and Pakistan Army was actually focused towards Afghanistan. And they wanted to be able to keep their focus that side, on their western borders. And I think this ceasefire did also help. But the ceasefire, in any case, is welcome, has to be welcomed by Indian side also, because whether it is the soldiers on the LOC or it is the people who live on the LOC, it is always a welcome relief to not have firing disrupt their daily lives. So I think all in all, the ceasefire has been a good thing. But coming to as to the infiltration attempts, I feel as we have started seeing some violations of that ceasefire, which was sort of reinvigorated after the ceasefire has been in place. So now we are seeing more and more incidents happening. And it is my guess that I don't see it lasting for very much longer. And I think this will perhaps break down, because as you also said, to push in terrorists, they have to have, firing across the LOC will increase. As the numbers are dropping in the valley because of very active operations by security forces, numbers of terrorists that are dropping in the valley, and the local recruitment is less, I think they will step up infiltration, and we are likely to see more infiltration attempts, also perhaps more cross LC firing in the near future.
LC getting hot again, sir. This contradicts the Pakistanis' entire motive of actually getting a ceasefire, because they wanted to get a ceasefire to concentrate on their own Western Front. So is it that they are now shifting focus back because they feel that their Western Front is stable enough to kind of, handle what is happening over there? Or is it that these elements that they have followed, if I may use a very, very crass word, for so long, are beyond their own span of control, sir?
So last part first, I think you are right that everything is not under very strict control. So that is an aspect they have to keep in mind. As to whether the Western, their Western borders or the attention that is required towards the West, to the West, they are facing their own problems as well. But certainly, now that the Taliban is in power in Afghanistan, there is a little easing of this pressure for the Pakistan army. There is also this feeling that, Pakistan has emerged victorious within Pakistan itself, as far as their influence, if I may use the word, with Taliban is concerned, as far as the way things have turned out for them after the withdrawal of the US troops from there. So to that extent, and the fact that I started off this talk by, when we started talking this in the session, is that they need to do something in Kashmir. Otherwise, from their point of view, they would feel that unless we do something, they are losing ground here, because if people get so used to a good life, and tomorrow we've already seen there is a three-tier panchayat in place, elected panchayat in place, and very soon, sooner or later, we will have the electoral process and political aspirations of people are met if a new government comes to power in the state. So when all these things happening, people will start enjoying a good life. I do concede that the alienation in their minds is there. The disappointment at being bifurcated into two union territories instead of one state. So that is there. But those are the things perhaps the governments can work at. So coming back to the point, I think the terrorist groups will be most interested to ensure that things don't improve so much that people forget violence.
Sinister motive, sir. One of the things, sir, that you brought on this, my final question for this particular thing, is that we've got a very strong infiltration grid in Kashmir. They are trying it from Punjab and other sectors, and you've cautioned about the three aspects of their tactics that they would use against us. What would you like to see happening on the ground as a former GOC of that region and having dealt with this entire issues for most of your career, as a matter of fact, and most of every army man's career? What would you like to see happening on the ground so as to curtail this kind of activity from all the fronts that they're trying to open?
Well, I feel what is required, it is not that it is not being done, but I'm saying the need of the hour is to have better synergy between all the security forces and intelligence agencies, to use more and more technical enablers, both physically on the line of control or to gather intelligence. And let's not leave out the human. Human is also a very important aspect. Somehow it tends to get a little neglected because we have a lot of tech end coming in. So I think what is required is to concentrate on the human as well, because it can complement the tech end very well. So if we create more intelligence, I think that's a smarter way of doing things. The infantryman will patrol on the LOC. I've done that for years. But if he has better intelligence, he can be more focused in his operations. And I think that is what we need to do. We need to have smart operations. And that is where, while a terrorist can go and create violence anywhere, this kind of targeted killings or soft targets can happen. But as a security force, I feel that we should target ourselves to having better synergy and having a smarter way of stopping them. And that can only be done by very good synergy between the intelligence agencies and the army in the frontier and all security forces, including the army and Rashtriya Rifles at the rear in this counterterrorism grid.
Interesting, sir. I think you've brought out something very, very interesting, that this is not just a spate of violence. It's not just some series of events that are taking place as coincidences. You know, some of the killings have been really, really, really sad to see. The photographs that we all see coming out is not something that we've seen in the valley for the past, I think, 2.5 years. Especially after the, you know, Article 370 was removed, we've not seen these kind of civilian, you know, targets and stuff like that. So there is something up, which I think us analysts and a lot of people interested in national security are now picking up and trying to talk about. I think General Dua has brought out this entire thing very nicely, so that we all understand that there is a sinister motive being played out in that particular region, including Punjab, and that's something that we need to be worried about. Sir, thank you so much for... Please.
Can I just say one last sentence? I'm not trying to have the last word, but your last words actually inspired this sentence in me, or this thought in me. Targeted killings, in this case, I think to my mind, are targeted at instilling fear. Because in the last 2 years, amongst the youth, amongst the people, amongst the common people who... there has been a hope has been created. A hope of a better life has been created. And everyone wants to take part in, or bulk of the people, most of the people want to take part in that growth, in that living a normal life. People are fed up of violence. So I think these targeted killings are to target that hope and to instill fear. Thank you.
May just have the opposite effect, sir. I don't know if you saw the interview or the talk. The small comment that was given by that medical shop, I'm forgetting the gentleman's name, his daughter. That was something to be reckoned with. She said, "You can keep killing people, but you'll never kill our spirit." And I think that underlines the entire thing. If people have built up a certain hope, I think. Somewhere down the line, and I hope for this as well at my end, that hope should keep the peace together and the people together with the yearning for a better future. Thank you, sir, for bringing out and interjecting it right at the end. Sir, till next time for another subject, another day. Jai Hind, sir.
Jai Hind. Thank you.